Welcome to another episode of Bucs Weekly. I am your host, Jeff Barnes, and boy, oh boy, here we are again for the third time in 4 weeks. We have the Bucs falling in a game, this time to the lowly Pittsburgh Steelers. And I say lowly not because the Pittsburgh Steelers have been bad for many years, but because they only had one win coming into this matchup. Everybody picked this to be a get-back game, and it was anything but that for the Bucs. It was a struggle. They couldn't find the end zone, and they lost as they finally found the end zone late in the game. They couldn't get the two-point conversion to tie. It was a war of attrition in the red zone for the Bucs. So we'll get all that. But while we're at it, let's go right into the highlights, or the lowlights in our case, if you're rooting for the Bucs.
Second goal, Pickett. Dumps it out to Harris, and Harris is in. Kenny Pickett's first passing touchdown of his career, and Pittsburgh has the early lead. But their first drive, they went three and out, trying to do better here. Fournette with a hole on the left side, and he lowers his shoulders so strong. Second and 10, sets up to pass. Perfect strike, complete. There's his top target, Mike Evans. Of course, Byron Leftwich was a backup for Ben Roethlisberger here for three seasons. Brady throws, deflected. It was going to get to Cameron Brate, but a field goal so far this season. He's hit 300 field goals in his career. Looking for 301 now. And he's got it to put Tampa Bay on the... Started last week at Buffalo, and now starting again today, week six. Hands to Harris. And Harris, and now on third and six, here comes some pressure. And Pickett fires a strike. Did he get both feet in bounds? Yes. Deontay. And it's a long one, 55-yarder for Boswell. It hits the crossbar and goes through. Brady sets his feet out of the gun, over the middle, and it is caught by Godwin. Now they got to get on the ball quickly. Brady gets up and snaps it. Does he have enough? He does. Ryan Succop, 54-yarder. He's got all nine of Tampa Bay's points.
Here today against Pittsburgh, able to steal those 3 points.
And Pittsburgh will get the ball here to start the third quarter. Steven Sims. Oh, Steven Sims with some space. It's a foot race. Sims. Oh, he lost the ball at the end, but he fell right back on it. He takes it down to the 10. What a return. More of Zach Gentry at the tight end spot. Third down and four for Pickett. Steps up, fires, too much. Was looking for George Pickens. Yeah, he's looked the way of Pickens four times, but only been able to connect once. And Boswell hit from 55 off the crossbar earlier. This one much easier. Brady just 11 to 22 throwing it. Over the middle. How did he fit that in there? My goodness. Tampa Bay searching for their first touchdown of the afternoon. Fournette right up the gut. And a strong run takes. Hand off Fournette, and he's taken down in the backfield. Play clock dwindling. 13th play of the drive. Brady under pressure, steps up. Gage tries to grab it, but he cannot. It's incomplete. Right through his hands. Makes Succop's job a little bit easier. Chip shot from 24. And he's perfect today. 4 for 4. He's got all 12 of Tampa Bay's points. Pickett just 67 yards passing. Play fake here. He's going to let it go, and he's hit as he does. And it's caught. Johnson came back to get it. He was covered by Davis, but he came back to grab it. It's Trubisky in at quarterback for the injured Kenny Pickett. Steps up in the pocket, lets it fly, and it's caught for the first down. What a big conversion.
That's the thing. If you're going to get to that second layer, you got to be able to control the first.
And now they try to get Vea off the field on time. Either way, it's completed to Hayward. Flag is down. Hayward is rumbling, bumbling, and stumbling down to the 10. The rookie tied in, and yes, he's the younger brother of Cameron Hayward. Eighth play of the drive, Trubisky. For the end zone, caught, touchdown, Chase Claypool. Touchdowns by Pittsburgh, all field goals in between. Tom Brady on 3rd and 11, complete but short. It's Rashad White out there. It was Fournette last time that ran for it on 4th and 1. You circled Evans, but they go underneath to the rookie White, and he has just enough. 13th play of the drive coming up. Two fourth down conversions on this drive for Brady. Underneath Fournette. Inside the 10, inside the 5, and into the end zone. Leonard Fournette powering his way in, and they can tie it with a two-point conversion. Brady. Over the middle, batted down. What a play by Devin Bush to keep this a two-point game. Claypool right now over the middle as Trubisky searches. And is that ball caught? Yes, it is. It's Claypool again. A monster game for number 11 continues. Another third down conversion. What a catch, Moose.
What a throw, and what a catch. Mike Tomlin has started off 1-4 a couple other times during his career. He's never had a losing season. He never seems to lose the locker room or create any question within the locker room. This was such a galvanized team and performance.
So there you have it. We sort of... We hate to say highlights when you lose, but it's highlights nevertheless. The red zone is clearly a problem for the Buccaneers, and it's impacted every one of their games so far, even the games they've won. We saw it in Dallas, one touchdown. Everything else, field goals. We saw it against the Saints, one touchdown. For the most part, field goals. All right, so they are really, really living off of Ryan's sucker. Tom Brady's had to throw the ball more because they're struggling to run the ball consistently. See, everything is Tom Brady down the field. Tom Brady. You're not seeing a lot of Leonard Fournette runs because there aren't a lot to highlight. They're just not. You get a 10-yard run here, a 15-yard run there, then a lot of twos, threes, a couple of losses there in the red zone. Two big negative carries for them that set up field goals. So, once again, the red zone is a major issue for this Buccaneers offense, and it is impacting how they're winning and losing games right now. By the way, wearing the gold today of the Cypress Creek High School Coyotes, 6-1 Coyotes for the first time in their school history. He's got a shout out to my high school, school that I coach at, not where I went. So, getting back to it here in the Tampa area. Shadow special season. So, not a special season for the Bucs so far through six games. All right, through six games, it's been a very mediocre team, and the record shows it 3-3. Mediocre. All right, great win to open the season versus Dallas. Really had to scratch and claw and get kind of lucky versus New Orleans that you had the altercation on the field that took Lattimore out of the game, because honestly, that touchdown doesn't come if Lattimore is in the game, and most likely they do lose that game to the Saints because they could not get in the end zone. So yeah, and then they lose two straight. Green Bay, the Kansas City that we addressed last week, they have the tight win over the Falcons when you were up 21-0. Need that bogus roughing the passer call to basically ice the game, because honestly, if there was no roughing the passer, they're punting And it's going to be Atlanta with the ball down 8 with 3 minutes left in the game. So, yeah, there's a lot, you know, a lot of foul in Denmark, you know, here in Tampa. So, when you look at it, it starts with this offense. The defense played very well for them this year. Had their moments last week where you really looked at it and go, ooh, what's going on here? Because even when Pickett went out the game, Trubisky went down the field and then found the end zone to Claypool. And Claypool had a great bounce-back game for himself. So there's a lot going on, a lot to unpack when you talk about this situation. And then have, once again, another struggling team that you're going to have to face, a division opponent, Carolina, who has starting quarterback out. And you know, they've just fired their head coach. They've got an interim head coach. They just traded their star wide receiver because he was unhappy. You know, there's a lot, you know, going on in Carolina. So when you look at what's going on with the Bucs, you may have less turmoil in your house, but overall, this is a team that could surprise you. This is that, you know, don't take the cheese game, because plain and simple, you know, these guys can surprise you. They got nothing to play for. You know, coaches are coaching for their jobs. Players are playing for their careers there in Carolina, because with a new regime coming in next year, you don't know who's going to be around. So games like Carolina are dangerous for that specific reason. And it starts with a lot of things. Let's talk about in-house. Okay, so we talked about it. We didn't talk about this. Okay, so everybody talked about this situation, and everybody says it's Tom Brady. He's getting his guys in order, you know, but it didn't look like a fire-up session as much as I'm putting my foot in your rear end session. And really, he didn't have horrible protection in this game. So I don't think his anger should have been with these guys as much as the receivers. In the running game, you could yell at these guys a little bit. You know, they got to move bodies so Leonard Fournette can get going. You need the running game. So, yeah, we need to run the ball better. I can't throw this every down all day. But you also go in that hot tub room and give some of this to guys like you know, Julio Jones. You know, you brought him in to be a weapon. He's been a limited weapon for you in 6 games. So he hasn't been on the field. You know, you can't win from the tub. So that's a major thing for Tom Brady. He's one less option for you. You're like guys like Justin Gage. You paid money to come here and help get open and had a chance to make a big catch in the end zone and dropped it. You had to get mad at who else? I mean, you can get a few ways. You know, Cam Brate left the game on a board, so you can't get mad at Cam Brate. But sometimes you got to also look at Tom Brady and say, am I playing my best football right now? You know, he's making some great throws. The throws up the seam to Godwin were amazing. But the pressure has impacted him so much that anything that comes near him up the middle is going into the dirt. That's Tom Brady. So don't just yell at these guys. Look in the mirror and yell at yourself, because you have to be just as accountable as you are. And a lot of them throws, you could stand in there and take the shot, throw the ball, and follow through. You're falling backwards because you don't want to get hit. And it shows on film. And what's happening is that ball is hitting the dirt. You're choking up on the ball. Okay, young quarterbacks do that. So, yeah, that's on Tom. So there's a lot of blame to go around in that locker room right now. And right now, if you look at everything that's going on, yeah, it's definitely it's disconcerting. You know, you expected a lot more out of this Bucs team than 3-3, struggling to score touchdowns at the Redskins, struggling to score touchdowns totally. And, you know, it's just one of those things where you have to really, really, you know, self-scout, self-evaluate, and check yourself and say, are we doing our best? Because right now it doesn't look like they're doing their best. It doesn't mean that they're not trying. I think there's a lot of effort. I don't, you know, but I think right now what Coach, you know, said, you know, is right. They're in, some of these guys are in fantasy land. So, and it's a fair assessment. I'm not beating him up just to beat him up. That's just what it is. You know, when you're in a situation, and I've been in it as a player, I've been in that situation as a coach, you know, when you are a better team than you're showing and you are struggling, sometimes it's a matter of going in the mirror and looking at yourself, say, what am I doing wrong? I need to step up my game and do better. And right now, that's what the Bucs have to do. They got to step up and do better because, honestly, that team on Saturday in Pittsburgh, they should have beat. Whether it was in Pittsburgh, whether it was in Johnsonville, whether it was on the moon, doesn't matter. They were the better team, not only on paper, but you saw it on the field. They were the better team on the field. However, execution-wise, they were not. Pittsburgh found the end zone on more than one occasion, starting on their first drive. Bucs went 3-and-out on their first drive. So, yeah, there's a lot to unpack when it comes to what we're seeing right now from this Tampa Bay team. So there's a lot, when you look at it, that they have to fix. And it starts with the offense. Defensively, they've been in ball games. Now they got to tighten it up some more because teams are starting to figure out how to move the ball on them. Before, that zone that was picking everybody off was not yielding the same results anymore. So now there's going to be some changes going on there on the defensive side of the ball where they've got to be a little less predictable after six games because teams are starting to see how to move the ball on them. The Pittsburgh Steelers struggled to run the ball this year. They made some big plays on the ground, as you saw a couple of those highlights, right? They made some big plays on the ground. They were able to execute a three-minute offense to kill a clock at the end of that game. And once again, with Trubisky in there, who they benched for Pickett. Pickett left with a concussion, right? So there's a lot to unpack with this game, all right? But before we go on, we have a commercial break coming up. We're going to come back with more. But before we go on, I would be remiss if I didn't bring up our good friends at FanDuel. That's right. Football fans, we have a great offer for you from our newest partners, FanDuel Sportsbook. Sign up for a new FanDuel account by using our special link located in our description, and you'll get a no-sweat bet up to $1,000. That means you can bet up to $1,000 on your first wager risk-free. FanDuel will give you the amount you wager back in free bets if you lose. So go ahead and bet on your favorite team this Sunday, and even if they lose, you are taken care of. To claim this special offer, just click the link in the description and create a new account. Then make the first bet on what you like. That's it. Win some money at FanDuel today. And we'll be back with more Bucs Weekly right after this.
Enjoy 40% off site-wide. Vitable takes the guesswork out of feeling good. Get your own personalized daily vitamin pack safely delivered to your doorstep every month. Take their online quiz to find out which vitamins and minerals can support your personal needs based on your own diet and lifestyle. Hashtag only what you need, nothing that you don't. All vitamins are manufactured in Australia at the highest quality standard. Ingredients come in the best form for their absorption by your body. Enjoy 40% off site-wide using code NBS40 at checkout.
Bucs Weekly. Once again, this is the Week 7 edition. Now we're going to turn our focus to their new opponent, the Carolina Panthers. So we talked about the train wreck of a season that they're having in Carolina. Ours pales in comparison. And listen, we're at 500. It's 3-3. We had a hot start, cooled off, lost three of our last four. So right now, Tampa is still the same thing. We're still having the same issues for 6 weeks on offense. Defense played amazing first couple of weeks and struggled at times the last 4 weeks, which is why we've had three of our last games result in losses. Now, where do they go from here? Well, we got to travel to a division opponent in Carolina. We know about Matt Rhule showing the door. We know about Robbie Anderson this week being traded to Arizona. So, a lot of things going on. Steve Wilkes has inherited a train wreck there in Carolina. So, where does this team go to get back to its winning ways? Right? And we've talked about this in the past where they have to figure something out here. The team that we saw dominate Dallas week one. Nothing. Okay, we're still seeing that same offense that can move the ball down the field, but can't finish in the end zone. Even if you want to look at it as Dallas, because the offense that we saw in Dallas, we're in for 100-plus yards. They ran for 130-something yards that day, 150 or something like that. Okay? Since then, very shaky. Very shaky. So, we're looking at a team that's struggling to run consistently, can't finish with touchdowns in the red zone, except for late in games when it's desperation. And honestly, they're having a lot of issues. Some serious issues. Okay, and they're starting to give up some big plays on defense. Not too many, but enough. That's the best I've seen a team run the football on them since Dallas this past week. In Pittsburgh, and that was inconsistent. So I think they're still very good against the run defensively. There's times when a pass defense leaks. We're not seeing that pressure. Remember I talked about in the preseason show, the kickoff show, that the edge pressure has got to win big. Well, the best pressure comes off of blitzes, which is telling you, when it comes to rushing four, they're not getting consistently there. So they're having to hide and mix up and show different looks to hide the four that are coming to be most effective. Won that Super Bowl against Kansas City. They put four guys up there and let those four guys rush, and they got home. They're not having that success now. Now it's about showing different looks, trying to confuse and pick a matchup. We were talking about Shaq Barrett a lot. We haven't said a lot of Shaq Barrett this year. And I know there were injuries involved, but still, he was healthy last week. You know, Devin White was there, but Devin White is blitzing. Right? So this is a guy that should be dropping in coverage at times. He's got a blitz because they're not getting there with four. All right? So we talk about Vita Vea collapsing the pocket inside. He's had some sacks, but he hasn't had a lot of consistent success doing that. You know, Akeem Hicks is hurt. You know, when he's back in the lineup and he's there, he's not 100% right now. So, I mean, we've talked about the issues. How do they fix it? Because they're not fixing it right now. Nothing's being fixed. It's the same thing for 6 weeks. And now you're going to bring that to Carolina, who's a division opponent, who's got nothing to lose because everybody's basically done there. It's going to be a cleaning of house for the rest of the season before the trade deadline and even after the season, but a lot more trades when the new regime takes over. You know, Steve Wilkes is coaching to try and get himself another job next year and the rest of that staff, because Matt Rule's the only guy that had guaranteed money. He could sit home and relax and collect checks. Those guys got to work, and they need to work next year. So you're going to get a team that's going to have some fire to them. Are they going to have more fire towards each other, like we saw last week? Or have, you know, equal fire for you, being a division opponent, being that they're being counted out? I think we're going to see a lot of heat come in Tampa Bay's way. So they better be prepared for this one. They need to go 4-3 in the worst way, especially with the way that the top of the NFC is shaping up. They're going to win the South. I don't think that the South is a problem. I think they'll win enough games to win the South. But being a low seed as a division winner is going to be shaky. You can get one of those teams that you don't need to see in the playoffs. Think about this. You look at the NFC East. Philadelphia is 6-0. The Giants are 5-1. Dallas is 4-2. We've seen Dallas already. Right? We know that they match up well versus Dallas, but they also faced Dallas when they didn't have a lot of receivers to challenge those corners. And Dallas seems to be getting a lot better. The Dallas team that's playing now playing a lot better than when they played week one, even with Dak Prescott. When they had Cooper Rush in there now, they were playing even better than when they had Dak Prescott in there. Right. So that's one thing in itself right there. Okay. The Eagles, the team that the Bucs mopped up in the first round last year, are playing a lot better football. But most importantly, offensively, they're playing a special brand of football that's hard to mimic. They're a unique team, okay, offensively, which is why they're undefeated right now. Because what they're doing offensively, nobody else can duplicate. Maybe Baltimore. But Baltimore doesn't have the receivers that they have. So Philadelphia is a unique challenge there. And right now they're playing so well that they're a balanced breakfast. Okay, you're going to get in a running game. You're going to get a passing game. You're going to get some good defense out of them right now. Those DBs are playing out of their mind. So they're a very balanced breakfast right now. That's why they're 6-0. All right, the Giants just seem to be a tough out. Teams that should have beaten them can't seem to shake them off. Okay, Tennessee couldn't shake them off. They lost the opener. Right? Last weekend in Baltimore, couldn't shake them off. Down 10 in the fourth quarter. Lost by 7. Green Bay couldn't shake them off in London. They were up, I think, around 10 themselves, 20-10 or something like that at halftime. Lost. You can't shake these guys off. Dallas beat them. But they were in the dogfight the whole time. They couldn't shake the Giants off. Right? So this Giant team is a feisty team that doesn't go away. That's not a team you want to see in the first round of a playoffs. Right? So there are so many teams coming out of that conference, that division alone. Not to mention the rest of the conference. We've already seen them lose to Green Bay. Green Bay may be a wild card, maybe, depending on how the East looks. Depending on how the West looks. All right, so there's going to be a lot of tough outs come playoff time in the NFC. You don't want to be one of those low division winners, because you're going to get a matchup that just may not fit. The way this team is playing, the way some of those teams may be playing down the stretch, they better get right real soon, because it's going to get out of hand. 3-3 is the case now. We see Minnesota just added Odell Beckham Jr. Minnesota's in first place right now. They're making third place moves, right? Desperate to improve? Well, they're in first place. They're desperate to lock it up and pull away. They know they got firepower coming at them in the next couple of weeks. So you better believe teams are making moves. And it's time for the Bucs to start to make a move, right? So we talked about get right game last week versus Pittsburgh. You know, let's double down on that for Carolina this week. They need a win. They desperately need a win. And Carolina is just the team to give it to you if they're fighting each other instead of you. So, once again, I'm going to call this the get-back game, and my prediction is going to be Tampa Bay 23. Tampa Bay 23, Carolina 6. Okay. notice I said 23, which means there's a lot of field goals involved. Okay. I'll give them two touchdowns and three field goals. Okay. 23. Right. Because that's what we're seeing is a lot of field goals, not as many touchdowns, but they've been getting one and a couple of field goals. So we'll give them 23-6. Right. I think they hold Carolina to six. I think they turnovers off this Carolina team. I think the defense holds up its end of the bargain. They get back above 500, you know, get the eyes and the nose above the water of 500 to 4-3. And they got to make a real push at this after this. So Sunday, 1 o'clock, Tampa Bay at Carolina. My prediction, 23-6, Tampa Bay. They've made me wrong several times this season. Let's hope we get this one right. So, until next week, the Bucs Weekly, I am your host, Jeff Barnes, signing off. We hope you have a great weekend. Go Bucs. Until next week.